Futurama is brought to you by
Squarespace. There is seriously no easier way to build your own website than with Squarespace. In 2007, the first Futurama straight-to-DVD movie, Bender's Big Score, was released and gave us our first adventure with the Planet Express crew since the show's first cancellation in 2003. It was largely enjoyed by fans, myself included, delivering not just a fun Futurama adventure, but another heartwarming, Fry-and-Leela-centric story that toyed with our emotions. And while I think Bender's Big Score delivered a very solid and emotionally satisfying story as its first return to our TV screens, it's impossible for hardcore fans of the show not to acknowledge that this movie also created some inconsistencies with the show's in-universe history. I'm of course talking about Lars Fillmore and the changes to Fry's timeline that take place simply due to his existence. I've previously talked about the history and timeline of Philip Fry and his relationship to his family, but I pointedly did not talk about how Lars Fillmore may have altered that history, and there's a major reason for that. Their timelines simply don't line up. The things that we were explicitly shown in some of these episodes that focused on flashbacks with Fry's family cannot coexist with what we were shown in Lars Fillmore's life between the years 2000 and 2012. But I got a lot of comments on that Fry family video bringing up Lars and the time he spent back in the 2000s, so I thought a good video topic might be actually discussing the contradictions between the Fry family flashbacks and Lars' 12 years in the past. So let's talk about it. But first, today's video is brought to you by Squarespace.
Whee! We're online!
Squarespace is the all-in-one platform to build your online presence or run your business. It's seriously so user-friendly. I sat down and threw together this really nice-looking website in a single afternoon, and it's ridiculously customizable. Check it out, I made a website that still matches the aesthetic of my brand and YouTube channel, highlighting some of my favorite video essays I've worked on, as well as some of the recent productions I've worked on professionally. Head over to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to push that website public, use my link, squarespace.com/johnny2cellos, to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Alright, let's get back to Futurama. Lars is a character I talked about extensively in another video, and I really love what his development means for Fry, but as I said, that development did come at the expense of some continuity. So looking back at the Fry family timeline, we really have to start our journey pretty much the moment the clock struck midnight in the year 2000. The original Fry family timeline looks like this. Fry is frozen as the clock strikes midnight in the year 2000. The next day, Seymour attempts to get the Fry family to help search for Fry, but they instead eat leftovers from the night before and all get sick. Seymour then searches desperately for Fry all around New York, eventually discovering him frozen at the Applied Cryogenics Lab. After the family gets over their illness, they go to retrieve Seymour from the cryogenics lab, not noticing their son in the cryogenic freezer tube right in front of them. Seymour sits outside of Panucci's Pizza and waits for Fry. At an unspecified point after his disappearance, implied to be in the early 2000s, Mrs. Fry dreams of Philip and claims she does so regularly. Somewhere around the mid-2000s, Yancey tries on his father's tuxedo and gets ready for his own wedding. Yancey goes downstairs to look through Fry's old records and discovers his lucky seven-leaf clover. In 2007, Yancey's son is born, he gives him his brother's lucky clover, and decides to name him Philip J. Fry to carry on his spirit. In 2012, after 12 years of waiting, Seymour dies in front of Panucci's Pizza. Now if I can get serious for a moment, let's talk about Fry's time paradox duplicate. In the events of Bender's Big Score, a version of Fry uses the time code to return to the year 2000, and then uses the time code again to eat warmer pizza. By doing this, he creates a time paradox duplicate of himself. Our Fry is refrozen, returning to the future, while the Lars Fillmore duplicate remains in the year 2000. This is his timeline. Shortly after midnight in the year 2000, Lars leaves the cryogenics lab and arrives back at Panucci's Pizza. He decides to rent the storage area above Panucci's Pizza and return to the life he never had in the 2000s. During this time, he spends time with his dog Seymour, taking him on deliveries with him. He spends quality time with his entire family, completely reintegrating into his lost life, and he plays basketball with his brother Yancey, once again using that seven-leaf clover for luck. Of course, all while he deeply misses Leela. In the year 2003, Lars applies for a job to take care of a struggling narwhal named Lilu, and against all odds, he gets the job. Lars spends 7 years working with Lilu professionally at the old New York Aquarium before they decide it's time to let Lilu back into the ocean in 2010, despite Lars' objections. Lars immediately sets off on an excursion to find Lilu and take her back. He discovers her in 2012, but realizes that she belongs with her own kind, setting her free once again. Lars returns to New York. As he arrives home, Bender from the year 3007, who is tasked with killing Fry, fires a laser blast into Lars' apartment. The laser blast destroys the apartment and fast fossilizes Seymour. This also burns off Lars' hair and impacts his lungs, making him realize that he is the Lars that he knew in the year 3007. Lars returns to applied cryogenics and freezes himself again. So let's first talk about the things that absolutely do not line up between these two timelines. Primarily, the events of Jurassic Barkass scene are nearly wiped out of existence with this new Lars Fillmore timeline. In Bender's Big Score, we immediately see Lars greet Seymour on January 1st, 2000, meaning that Seymour no longer desperately searches for Fry that day, as seen in Jurassic Bark. Seymour no longer discovers Fry's body at the cryogenics lab, and his parents no longer nearly discover his body there when they retrieve Seymour. And of course, Seymour no longer waits 12 long years in front of Panucci's Pizza for Fry to return until his depressing death. Instead, Seymour is fast fossilized by Bender's laser blast, and interestingly, the fast fossilization actually lines up with what we did see in the future during the events of Jurassic Bark, but it doesn't line up with the events of the past from that episode. The other major issue is the events of Luck of the Fryrish. During the flashbacks in that episode, in what would have been the mid-2000s, the Fry family specifically refers to Fry as missing.
I'll never forget the day Philip disappeared.
Then in 2007, Yancey's son is born, and he specifically names him Philip J. Fry after his missing brother. If the events of Bender's Big Score are taken into account, none of these things could have happened this way, as the Lars version of Fry maintained his relationships with his family throughout that time period. But we do see that Fry's nephew is still named Philip J. Fry.
Phil, some kind of trash can here to see you?
And lastly, the thing that doesn't quite line up is Fry's mom's admission that she dreamed of Phil a lot since his disappearance. Now, the placement of this event in her timeline could be adjusted, which we'll talk about shortly, but the inclusion of the 2000 Rose Bowl in that dream, which was the game that played on the day Phil went missing, seems to imply it has significance with his mother in regards to her son's disappearance. But if we take into account the events of Bender's Big Score, this obviously was not the day that Fry went missing. So let's talk about how these things can be reconciled within the story, and I think there are two ways that this can be handled. One, the events of Bender's Big Score simply rewrite history and create a new version of events that supersede the events we saw in these flashback episodes, or two, the events of Bender's Big Score create an alternate timeline and parallel version of events, but maintain the events as we've seen them in their former timeline. Let's talk about the first one and how that might work. Obviously, we know that if the timeline is rewritten thanks to Lars' existence in the 2000s, the events of Jurassic Bark and Luck of the Fryrish did not play out as we saw them in those episodes. It's relatively easy to write off the events of Jurassic Bark because there's not really anything in Lars' timeline that ties us down to that version of events, so we can just assume that none of these events played out in this new timeline at all. However, Luck of the Fryrish poses issues with Fry's brother and nephew. Yancey and his parents lament the loss of Philip when preparing for his wedding in the mid-2000s, which obviously couldn't have happened in this timeline since Fry wasn't actually missing. But most importantly, this was when Yancey allegedly found Phil's seven-leaf clover. Then we're told that Yancey named his son Philip after his missing brother, passing on the seven-leaf clover to him in the process, which would go on to make the young Philip J. Fry incredibly successful. In this new timeline, we'd have to assume a few things in order to make it work. One, that Yancey had a new reason to name his son Philip, possibly because the two of them forged a stronger friendship and bond when Lars returned to the year 2000. In regards to the seven-leaf clover, we'd have to assume that Lars himself gave his nephew the seven-leaf clover before he refroze himself in the year 2012, or that Yancey discovered the clover at a later date and then passed it on to his son after the Lars version of Fry disappeared. And in this timeline, we have to assume that the younger Philip J. Fry's gravestone, which reads named for his uncle to carry on his spirit, is actually in reference to his second disappearance in the year 2012, even though it gets a little bit questionable since we know he was named before Fry went missing. And the last thing, which is actually probably the easiest to adjust, is Mrs. Fry's dream in which she says she dreamed about Phil a lot after he disappeared. In this timeline, we'd have to just assume that this takes place after the year 2012 when Lars refroze himself, despite the fact that the Rose Bowl on the TV implies a connection to January 1st, 2000. Technically, this isn't definitive, so we can ignore it if we want to. So that's how we can reconcile these timelines the first way, simply by reworking our headcanon for the events and adjusting them to incorporate Lars' timeline in the 2000s, rewriting history. But personally, even though this might not be what the writers intended, I prefer the second way, in which we consider these events parallel timelines. This is very simple. It just means that all of the events that we saw in Jurassic Bark, Luck of the Fryrish, and Game of Tones still occurred in an alternate reality, which is why we were able to see most of them in flashbacks. But when Fry went back in time during the events of Bender's Big Score, this created a new alternate version of events, It's like the Kelvin timeline in Star Trek. The J.J. Abrams movies are parallel to the original series, with a slightly altered history because of time-traveling events. The reason that I prefer this explanation is simple. It no longer removes the impact that these episodes have in regards to the Fry family tragedy of losing their son. As much as I love the idea of Fry going back and being able to spend time with his family and Seymour from a fan service perspective, it's hard not to think about that when watching Luck of the Fryrish or Jurassic Bark, how the events unfolding in these episodes actually never took place. If we assume they still took place in a parallel timeline, it maintains the importance of the lasting impact Fry had on his family, while also allowing us to indulge in the fan service of Bender's big score. Now, the one that will still ultimately cause problems is Mrs. Fry's dream in Game of Tones, since the events of Game of Tones actually take place after Bender's big score. This would seemingly imply that this dream takes place in the post-Lars timeline, which would mean that this dream takes place sometime after the year 2012. While it all still works from a timeline perspective, I might just further my headcanon that somehow Nibbler connected Fry to his mother's dream in that former parallel timeline, simply because the connection of Mrs. Fry's dream associating the 2000 Rose Bowl with Phil works too well when looking at all of these Fry family stories together. But if you're unwilling to do it, we can just say it's a coincidence that Mrs. Fry continually thinks about that football game that took place on the same day Fry initially went missing. Okay, so this has maybe been the most self-indulgent Futurama video yet, literally just me trying to work out the details of these in-series contradictions, but honestly, I think it's a fun exercise in continuity and headcanon. I personally don't really hold it against the writers for doing what they did with Bender's Big Score. Despite the issues it creates with the continuity, Bender's Big Score is for sure my favorite of the Futurama movies, and I think it was smart for the story of the characters to be prioritized over the minutiae of the show's continuity. Ultimately, the Lars story was one of my favorites in all of Futurama, and I think it would have been a shame if we didn't get such an impactful story simply to avoid continuity mistakes. But that's, of course, just my opinion. Heck, I made an entire video about how much I love Lars Fillmore and why his story was not only satisfying, but why it was important for our Fry as well. And based on how many views that thing has, you guys gotta feel kinda similarly. But that's where I wanna pass it off to you. How do you feel about the issues between Fry and Lars timelines? Were you able to compartmentalize the continuity mistakes like I did and embrace the quality storytelling they gave us? Or did it ruin the older episodes for you forever? Let me know below in the comments. Also, you know, like and subscribe and all that, and stay tuned for more. Peace. Johnny!